Get those nerds! Nerds!
Well, we skipped the big opening. We did the, we did the short opening. We queued up the wrong one.
Oh, we're back on time now.
Yeah, right. That made up for some time. See, we could do hours. We could do it this way, and we could be like dancing along.
Get those words.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, you get the point. So there it is. We already started the show.
That's one way to do it.
You know, it's Tuesday, but it sure feels like a Monday. Welcome, everybody, to a dumpster fire of a Tuesday show. This is the Bid Nerds, your daily nerd out on the most interesting cars of the day on all the automotive enthusiast auction websites like Rad ForSale, Bring a Trailer, and Cars and Bids. We had some technical issues this morning, so sorry we're late to all of you. You who are sitting by your computer just like waiting for Bid Nerds to start, but for all four of you, we do appreciate you guys. Thank you for hanging out.
Yeah, we could almost name them, right? It's like, you know, Chachi, right? And Mark.
Exactly.
David Sullivan. And you know, yeah, that's about it,
and some guy in Reseda. I'm thinking we might have a couple of new followers. I had an interesting so I'm a little, not only are we late because we had technical issues, but I'm a little groggy. I stayed up a little late last night. Have you ever like been on Facebook and gotten in a flame war with someone? I mean,
no,
it's not really something I, you know, engage in very often. I purged everyone, you know, for when it comes to politics. There's like no politics on Facebook, but right. This is automotive related. Last night, a huge pet peeve of mine, and I'm sure you've seen this before, when you're, you know, there's classified ads all over the place on the internet, you know, Craigslist, all those different places, and of course the auction sites. One thing that drives me nuts is when there's a for sale group. Like on the internet, there's a bunch of different for sale groups on Facebook for like Porsche, or pretty much anything, right?
Right.
And then, you know, and someone posts a picture, someone posts an ad for their car, and then boom, you get all these yahoos that start making comments on their ad. It's like, this isn't a discussion forum, you idiots.
Yeah.
This is some guy's ad. What are you doing? Why are you, you know, oh, that thing, Tipperoni, it sucks, you know, whatever. It's like, just save it. If you want to comment on that guy's ad, copy it, put it in a discussion group and talk about it there, but don't talk about it on the guy's ad. It's maddening. Yeah. So this guy,
you're messing with the money that's going to be in his pocket. I mean, that's an asset. You're poo-pooing the asset because of the way he presented it, but it has nothing to do with the asset itself.
Right. Why are you trying to mess up the guy's sale? You wouldn't, I mean, that'd be like someone going on a car dealership lot with a big sign and a megaphone saying all the cars here suck. I mean, they would beat you up and throw you off the, lot.
It's illegal.
Well, there's that too. So here's a guy on one of these sites, and it wasn't a specific like Porsche site or whatever. It was just a local, you know, Summerlin swap in Las Vegas.
Oh wow!
Right. So it's just people putting all kinds of stuff.
It's, you know, niche.
You're right. And there was a particular car that I thought, speaking of niche, that really made sense for us. It was this guy was selling a 1988 Camaro IROC Z28.
I want that car.
I mean, it was so dope. It's like copper brown interior. I haven't seen one that colorway in years, and it was dope, right? I mean, the car was nice. So I'm sitting here going, oh wow, that's really cool. And the guy wanted $20,000 for it, which is pretty steep for one of those, but you know, if you
low miles,
the miles were a little high. If it were low miles, that I'd say that was a little bit more realistic.
Worth it. Yeah.
But then again, I mean, if that show, turn your mic down just a little bit, Deeb.
Sure.
If that car were on Bring a Trailer, I think it would be certainly up in the high teens. I mean, you know, and maybe it brings 20 because it was so pretty and so nice and looked like it was in really good condition. But those 80s and 90s cars, you and I know I'm preaching the choir out there. We all know what's going on with those cars from that era.
Yeah.
Guy goes on there, that POS ain't worth, and he didn't say POS, he said the whole words, that POS ain't worth $5,000, and he puts an NADA link, right? I'm just like, oh, here we go.
Wow, like, what a jerk.
I'm like, dude, you know, the NADA book is just for used car salesmen to rip people off on classic cars. Get out of here. You know, check Bring a Trailer and other auction sites to see the real market value, what's going on. Boom.
But
this just... Go ahead.
if that's what you're doing with your evening on a Monday night is poo-pooing somebody's classified ad on Facebook or the internet or something, I mean, don't you need to get laid? Like, what the hell is your problem? Like, good grief.
It blew up because everybody jumps in the fray. It was like a mosh pit, and this guy is like calling people, you know, he's dropping all kinds of insults. It got to the point where he's like physically threatening, you rest with the wrong beep beep beep, I know who you are, I'm gonna find you, I'm gonna kick your ass. He's making like criminally actionable and you looked at his profile, and he's like this roided out boomer. I mean, he's got like biceps the diameter of garbage can lids. I mean, the guy is just like, dude, take it easy. So he, and now he's DMing me, threatening me and everything. And he was all upset because he got blocked from the site. And I'm like, dude, I didn't
block
you.
He did it to himself.
You're an asshole. Yeah. It's like, how does it, and it turns out he was an ex used car salesman. He had a car dealership.
Of course he was. You know, of course he was.
And from Long Island, so maybe he worked for the P-Car Market guys. I don't know.
Oh, that's a terrible assumption.
At some point, I was like, you know, he was like, DM me, I'll send you the address to my house, and we'll see who's a pussy, right? I'm like, okay,
dude. Oh, my goodness.
We don't need your address. We all know where you live. It's the big, sad house on the end of the block that smells like low tea and divorce. All right? We get it.
Low
You're gonna be easy to find, right?
And divorce. Oh, man, that is amazing. Oh, I guess 60% of the time it works every time. You will smell like low tea and divorce.
Here's
it's amazing,
where it
too. What I'm gathering now, based on the description of his house, the description of his profile pic, and the description of the car, he's upset because he can't afford 20 grand for an IROC. He wants the IROC for 5, and he's upset that they're asking 20. And it so it's 15 really, grand out of his league. So whatever. And onward and upward. But listen, if you're cyberbullying people's want ads on classifieds on the internet, You need to regroup, man. Like, you need to take a hike up the tallest mountain and gather your thoughts. That's just like, that's a sad state of existence right there.
Find some Zen, my man. I actually did respond to him in the DMs, and I'm like, in between those, you know, dick ED shots and kicking my ass, let's go have a beer sometime. And he's like, and then like a big pause, and he's like, I like you. You stand up for yourself. So I think I made a friend. I've got a friend now.
Oh, awesome. Awesome.
So we're buddies.
Awesome.
We're going to go hang out.
That's how it goes. In the cartoons, when the little French poodle takes the thorn out of the big bulldog's leg, and then the bulldog's sweet on the French poodle or the little French bulldog, and he doesn't know what to do with his big, you know, pit bull friend. You've got that. JP, tell me about the Porsches, JP.
He was sending me pictures of his like Corvette and his Judge and all the classic cars. It was like, oh my god, I made a buddy. What just
That's
happened
awesome.
Here? I'm like, yeah, I'm
That's
pretty
awesome.
Sure I was conceived in that car. I couldn't get him to laugh. There was like no LOLs, no emojis, nothing.
He wasn't there yet.
Funny guy. Yeah. All right, we'll get him. We'll break him.
We'll
make him one of our people.
Baby steps to redemption. JP, you had a good day, man.
So what we do on this channel, other than lament about silly Facebook flame wars, is we actually nerd out on the most interesting cars of the day and on Bring a Trailer, Cars and Bids, all these auction sites. And we do make predictions as to what we think the cars will sell for or hammer for, sometimes not sell for, what they'll get bid to, and on and on and on. And we keep track of those numbers. And we always start the show with a quick recap of yesterday's cars and to see how we did. And what we usually determine by the end of that recap is that neither one of us know what the hell we're doing. And you should not listen to us. Listen to the dude who used to be a car salesman on Facebook. All right. Yeah. So yesterday's cars, what do we got?
Okay, JP. Our start of the day was on Brink Trailer. It was the 2008 Audi R8. Really nice car. There was a blemish on the Carfax, not necessarily a blemish on the car. We wondered if that might hold it back, even though it was on BAT. It was triple black. It was less than 40,000 miles. V8 Quattro with a manual transmission. Yes, this is a 6-speed manual mid-engine supercar from Audi. Basically, your poor man's Lamborghini Gallardo. Anyway, very cool car. Beautiful in the triple black. It did have the 19-inch wheels, which are the wheels you'd want on this thing. And we kind of overbid it a little bit. I said 74. You said 79. this car sold for $72,000, and one has to think that that incident on the Carfax report was what held it back from being closer to an $80,000 car. So very well bought, and congratulations to the seller. Obviously, it met the reserve, so there you go.
I don't know. I got to admit, so yesterday we were having serious audio issues, and I was having a hard time hearing, and I'm not trying to, I deserve the loss. I made my bet, but yeah. In my brain, I was thinking 69 because I didn't think this was a car that was worth much more than $70,000. I don't know what the hell I was thinking by saying almost 80. You can find versions of this car with higher miles or whatever for under 60. I mean, they're out there. There's 50, right. $58,000 R8 manuals all over the place.
Right.
So to bet almost 80, I don't know what the hell. I'm an idiot if I thought this thing was worth almost 80.
So you gave me one there. Yes, JP, I'll take it because I need it. You had a good day. Starting off with the Chevy Impala on Cars and Bids that you didn't like, which was really funny. I remember you interrupting me and saying, forget it. I hate this car. What's your bid? You were like, next. I said $14,000 for this one owner Chevy Impala SS. You said $11,500, and you were right on the money. This car sold for $10,800. As much as you don't like him, you sure know him pretty well.
You did ask me if this was the kind of car that was around my hometown growing up, and the answer is unequivocally yes. This is definitely a Snohomish, Washington car. There are a lot of bros driving these around. I wasn't one.
Mark grew up in, south of San Francisco in the Mateo, Foster City, kind of Silicon Valley area. And while we were reviewing this car, he's texting me going, dude, he goes, my friend had one of those, are awesome. And he goes, you're right, he used to sell weed. And I'm like, exactly. I mean, it was the drug dealer car, if ever there was one. I would imagine, JP, if you were driving one of those cars in period in the left lane of the freeway, everybody in front of you would move over, assuming you were a cop.
Yeah.
In of itself, that's got to be a cool feeling.
It does.
All right, JP. Yeah. My favorite car of the year probably so far is this Porsche from Bring a Trailer yesterday. Feast your eyes on our 1992 Porsche Unobtainium. This is a European model, an RS, and this one has the M003 package, which means it's a club sport. So not only is it RS with a seam-welded chassis and the higher spec motor, but the club sport means it's been gutted out even further to reduce weight. And better make this car turn laps at the racetrack. I mean, this is essentially a homologation model for GT racing back in the early to mid-90s. This car had 2,000 kilometers, which equates to about 1,200 miles, meaning it is basically brand new. The car is currently in Canada and is waiting to come to the United States to find the home of one of the two bid nerds so that we would drive the snot out of this thing and make everybody proud. Unfortunately, we knew this car was going to bring big money. I said 400. You said 390. The car stalled out at 341. Didn't sell at that price. So I think our numbers in that $400,000 range are correct. But it did not find its buyer on Bring a Trailer yesterday. So somewhere this car is going to pop up for sale. And it'd be interesting to keep an eye on what they ask for it because I'm curious to know. Just a stunning, rare, and basically brand new homologation special out of Weissach. This is not Stuttgart, JP. This thing, if they seem well to the chassis, this came out of the racing department.
Yep. Hey, Michael, you're going to have to turn your mic down quite a bit. Peeking out all over the place. This is definitely the car that both of us want. What do you think? Do you think, we haven't seen that many cars break 350. I mean, it just feels like as great and successful as BAT has been, it still seems like there is a cap on the really, really high dollar stuff. This car is definitely a $400,000 car, but didn't get anywhere near that. So what do you think happened?
I really don't know, to be honest. It's kind of weird. Maybe the fact that it's in Canada, that's a problem for some guys. It might behoove of somebody to bring it into the United States and put it on a domestic title. And then that being a way easier transaction, even for the tax bracket that's ahead of higher than you and I. So I don't
buying,
know.
Buying a car for that kind of money from a Canadian, are there extra fees that you're going to have to pay? Are there taxes or duties?
No, because you're bringing it in.
It's not, bring it, right?
It's not going to be operated in Canada. There might be a tariff bringing it across the border, but you're talking, it's like a formula where it's like 0.1% of the sale price or something. And those are you're paying that to the United States to import it, not to Canada to export it. So I really don't know what the holdup is. Whatever the fees might be, they're not the deal breaker, even at $400,000 and $500,000. If you're looking for one of these, it's a peerless car. You're not going to find another one.
Do you think it's because, I mean, if you're spending that kind of money, you want to be at a Barrett Jackson or a Sotheby's or something like that in person?
That's a good
put
take.
Eyeballs on the
that's
car
a really
and
good
actually
take.
See it in real life.
Well, that's part of it. And that guy at Barrett Jackson is wearing his favorite shirt, his lucky shoes. He's got his favorite blonde, and he's drinking his favorite white wine, and he's bidding. He's holding up his arm in a room full of his buddies, and that is a big part of the equation. If this is at RM, that finds a home, and it'll go for more than 400. That's for sure.
All right.
Bring a trailer. Bring what it's worth. RM will bring what the room yields, and that could be, you know, in the middle of a Saturday night, that could be a lot of money for that car.
I mean, we have how much did that Evo M3 go for? That went for 400, wasn't it? Or was that just 300? Yeah. I can't remember.
I don't remember, but it was
seems
big
like
money.
300 is the number that just kind of like taps out most BAT buyers. It's just odd.
Interesting. We'll have to keep an eye on that. We don't do a lot of big cars. We try to do cars that we think, you know, nerds can afford. But occasionally we do one or two a week that are big ticket items, and a few have sold. We saw that Saline sold, and we saw a Gullwing bring 1.15 million in an organic auction at the close on BAT. Those are impressive sales. All right, JP, moving on. Sorry. The 1967 Toyota Land Cruiser that was in Las Vegas found a home. I said 20. You said 18.5. And again, you were all over the money on that because it sold for $17,800. Congratulations to the buyer and the seller. I think that's the right money for that car. Yeah.
Agreed. I mean, I was definitely looking at it, I don't know. It had an engine swap, and there was a bunch of little weird things that just kind of made me turned off on it. If it were the original engine, that number is good. That's a really cool vehicle. I still think that the photos hurt that vehicle. The photos should have been of the car with the
top down windshield
like
folded.
Yeah. These photos were kind of like an afterthought that they put in at the very end. So most of the potential buyers didn't see these photos. They saw the ones with the big silly looking top, and it just really makes the thing look bad. But anyways.
Agreed. All right. Our last car was on P Car Market, and JP, you and I really did struggle trying to figure out a value for this thing. This was a build. It's a 1982 Porsche 911 SC, but the guy tacked on authentic steel flares to make it a wide body. He basically put the fiberglass front end to make it look like a IROC. He kind of shaved the lower rocker rails that go under the door on an SC to give it this sort of IROC look, and it's adorned with a pea shooter exhaust and the Turbo Carrera wing, which is my favorite wing. It was treated to some H4 headlights and a prototipo, and the top end of this motor was built, so it probably sounds good and drives great. This is a really nice car. However, how do you quantify a value for it, and how do you quantify whether or not that value can be achieved on this particular platform? So this was, of any car we've looked at so far, this is one of the ones where we're really just shooting in the dark. So I said 55, you said the under at 54, and then we both wondered if that would even be enough. And so I think at the end of this, when we were looking at this car, we both agreed this car would wind up in the deal tank. And in a lot of ways, we were right. So the car brought $56,750 as its highest bid, but that did not meet the reserve that was set by the consigner on P Car Market. It failed to sell at that mark and remains available in P Car Market's deal tank for an asking price of $75,000. But you are welcome to make an offer on it. There it sits. The bid goes on.
Yeah, I think this car's worth around 60-ish. I think 70 is absurd. I mean, it is just an SC engine. I mean, it's a really cool build, and I said yesterday that it is kind of the way I would do it. I like this car a lot, but it's just not worth that kind of money. We bet the platform, you know, accurately. I think the platform just doesn't. Yeah, P car is way too all over the place, and cars like this just definitely aren't going to bring the money there. Something kind of modified.
A
like
three, a 3-liter SC with that build, I mean, that has our group potential, but that motor is too mundane. You got to do like a more exotic intake system, like either individual throttle bodies or a high butterfly design. And then you open up the thing and you're like, oh my God, it looks like an RSR. But this one didn't have all that. So
you got to have the jewelry under the hood. I mean, you need the, you need a 3.6 in there or something like that to go.
Or you engine swap. Yeah. But if you're going to do that motor, you got to build it like it's supposed to look. He's got the stock airbox and you're like, oh, that thing ain't going to beat anybody in a race.
Yep. Yep, exactly. Right, neat car, though, JP. But there it is. All right, so that was yesterday.
Yeah, you had 3, I had 2. We're off to a good start.
All right, so that's what we do, guys. We nerd out on these cars. We make our predictions, and then we move on to today's cars. So before we get to the cars that are the most interesting ones on Cars and Bids and Bring a Trailer, make sure you hit the subscribe and like button, hit some notification button so that you know when a new show is going live. Need it. You know we do a new show every Monday through Friday at around 9 o'clock. So, you know, just show up on YouTube and be ready to nerd out with us because you're a nerd. You're watching this. That means you must be a nerd. All right. So what cars do we have? Our big car today actually isn't even a car. It's a box. It's a bread box.
What?
It's a giant rectangle with wheels.
Wow. You're going to do it? Is the Volkswagen? Is that it? Is that our
is the
star car
of the day? That is correcto.
I tell you what, I actually like this thing. I think it's really cool. This car is some neat wheels, a cool little exhaust system, and some stickers away from being really, really dope. What we're talking about here, JP, is a 1986 Volkswagen, codenamed the T3, which is essentially a transporter that's sort of built, I'm paraphrasing here, JP, on the Vanagon platform. It's a Doka Syncro, which means it's Volkswagen's all-wheel drive system. The owner of this car has had it for the last 31 years. It's offered out of Carefree, Arizona, but shows an unbelievably low 59,000 original miles. It is motored by the 2.1-liter flat four that's from Volkswagen. JP, quick question. That air-cooled or water-cooled?
That is a water pumper.
It has a 5-speed manual transmission. It's not an automatic. And again, as I mentioned, this is a all-wheel drive vehicle. Now you've got this basically usable transport flatbed thing. Those sides, I think, fold down, JP, and you get kind of a high-backed flatbed, or you can leave them up and you have something that's like an extended cab pickup truck. It's not very difficult to tell that this Volkswagen was way ahead of its time. I mean, essentially, this car came to the U.S. about 10 to 15 years too early, because if they were building that today, they would not be able to keep them in stock. These things have a cult following, and there's probably a million different uses you can create for your Volkswagen T3 transporter. JP, tell me what I didn't say.
Oh, you covered most of it, man. This is such a good off-road vehicle, and to not have that big, you know, on a most usually Vanagons, obviously that whole area in the back is all part of the cabin. So to have this lower back, it's just a different type of utility. Does it offer much room for camping or whatever? No, but honestly, I've never, as much as I like the Westphalias and the Weekenders with their pop tops and stuff, and even a normal Vanagon van, the interior, if I'm camping, I don't really want to sleep in the van. I'll put a tent outside or something like that.
Yeah.
And, you know, and because it's like when you're camping in there, it's like too much extra stuff to I don't know. This thing is really cool. How awesome would it be to put like an espresso machine on the back of this or roll around?
Oh, yeah, Cars and Cafe.
Right.
Every day it would be Cars and Cafe.
Yeah, no, I mean, and, you know, the fact that it's a Syncro is just makes this a Syncro and a Doka and an extended cab. This is an almost unique. What's that?
What's the difference? What specifically Syncro is the all-wheel drive. What does the Doka mean in Volkswagen speak, JP?
So the Doka means that it's the it has the flat bed with the side skirts. So hold on, I'll bring the picture up again.
So the T3 transporter is called a Doka.
All Vanagons are transporters. Actually, all buses and Vanagons are technically transporters. So what makes this a Doka is the fact that it's a pickup, basically.
Yep, got it.
And the fact that so this one has the third door. They did make Dokas that were just a, you know, a single cab. So, right. And then from, you know, I'm kind of
Gary has something like that, the old bus style.
Yeah, so they made them in the buses too, in the old transporters, and you know, it look the with the extra cab in this, it's just the perfect utility vehicle, bug out rig.
Totally.
I mean, how cool
Seriously.
Is this thing?
I really
like
this one.
It's got a cool
one.
Brush guard, and yeah, they did make one that was called the TriStar, which I believe was like 89, 90 or something like that in the last year that they made them. And that had a 5-speed and it, you know, had a much nicer interior, but it was also the, you know, this kind of setup. And those, I know of one in Washington, Pignataro Volkswagen, our good friends up there, you know, Tony Pignataro has one. He's had one for years. And we used to drive it around all the time and take it to events and stuff like that. So just, these are so much fun to drive around.
JP, did you notice how clean the interior is on this? So he's got like a dash toupee and like sheepskins, but he takes another photo with all of those things off, and you can see that the interior of this car has absolutely been preserved. It looks brand new. I mean, it's really nice.
It does look hermetically sealed, which is
right?
something that you don't see very often on these types of rigs. Yeah, I want to spend some time in there. I want to go wheeling. I want to go camping. I want to just, you know, I mean, this is just a showstopper at car shows, too. There was a guy that actually had a Doka non-synchro here in Vegas. And they were trying to sell it over at one of the car dealerships here in town. But it was
really?
Just, it was such a beat. It was like, it was a repaint, and it was just really poorly restored, and you could tell
right.
from 10 feet away you could tell that it was a resprayed car. It was just like, oh, God, I want to love this thing, but it just wasn't there. Yeah, this thing is super clean. All right, so where's it out, and where's it going to land? What do you think?
All right, so JP, again, out of Carefree, Arizona, our 1986 T3 Doka Syncro Transporter has just 59,000 original miles, and by all accounts looks to be in pretty nice, pretty spectacular condition. It does still have about 4.5 hours to go before close. It's sitting at $28,500 on just 11 bids. It's interesting to note that it did not get a bid overnight. That's where it was last night. But I still think that this car is destined for a late late surge on BAT. You and I have lamented that a lot of water-cooled Volkswagens, you know, and I think what we're mostly talking about are like Mark IIs and Mark Ones, have not really gotten or found traction with the Volkswagen community on Bring a Trailer. They're not bringing the big money that some other brands or niche cars have. But I would say that the Vanagons and these platform vehicles, you know, especially the camping versions of these, have been bringing decent money on the platform. So I believe this car will make it to 37,000. I think it's going to have a great late surge because, again, where would you find another one, JP? There's no way you're going to find – this is a car that really is we haven't seen anything like it since we've been doing the show. You know, good luck trying to replace it if you let this one go. I don't think somebody's going to miss it. I think it's going to bring the money. 37,000, JP. Where are you at?
Where's it at now?
It's at 28.5 on 11 bids with 4 hours.
Yeah, I mean, this car is easily worth 40-something thousand bucks.
Right?
Maybe even 50. I mean, I remember the TriStar that was Tony's back, you know, and that was like 7 or 8 years ago driving that around, and people offering me like 30 grand for it. And so these have never been cheap. Syncros have been expensive for a very, very long time.
Right. Because
people recognize what they are, and there's a community built around them. A Syncro Doka, that is like, whoa. And then to find obscenely clean one, and I gotta tell you, I've kind of sat on this picture here. It's got a heated seat button on this column
of
the dash.
Goodness.
I have never seen that, and I've been in a million Vanagons and Syncros and stuff. I've never even heard of that, and
that's
would never
great.
Have looked for the button on the steering column. I would have looked for it on the side or something like that. That's amazing.
Yeah.
So yeah.
How easy is it to drop a VR6 in one of these things?
Not easy at all.
Not, okay.
Very
all
difficult.
Right, so you, okay, just curious.
But it's been done. And obviously I drop my buddy Zach all the time. He did it. Really, the swap to put in these is a Subi swap or a, you know, so a flat four from Subaru. Or a lot of people, there's a lot of people that are putting the T5, what are they, the turbo diesels. Five-cylinder turbo diesels in there.
The Audi
really
ones we were just
swap.
Talking about.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. That is a super, super common swap.
Okay.
So,
sorry.
And there's kits. No, no. It's a good question because this engine is not very good. But with this few miles, I mean, the thing is they actually drive pretty darn nice when they're well done. And, you know, they have surprisingly decent amount of power. You know, you wouldn't think that a 2.0 whatever. This is a 2.1, I think, water boxer would be able to move this big box, but it does fairly smoothly if the engine's sorted out. You know, you're probably going to have to replace the head gaskets very soon because the aluminum heads and the aluminum block, they warp, and that's a big problem on this. But anybody that gets into one of these, anybody that's going to spend this kind of money kind of knows their way around that. And if the engine does blow up, there's plenty of swaps out there. I'm going to say 40. I'm hoping for this rig. I'd like to see 50 for this thing. I haven't seen one in a long time.
Blue sky for sure on this car. There you go, JP. Really
if
cool
it
car.
If it stalls out on here, it'll be an interesting testament, or at least it'll be interesting data to take from BAT, because really this vehicle belongs on the Samba. That's where you're going to get all the money for it.
Absolutely.
Which is not an auction site. It's just an online
classified
forum classifieds. Yeah.
Forum so, classified. That's right. Yeah, the Samba. All right, JP.
Cool.
Let's jump over to Doug DeMiro's site. He got a 2007 M5. Hey, what's the big deal, you ask? This one's got a 6-speed manual. This is a very, very rare car with this gearbox from the factory. So out of Pikeville, Maryland is our 2007. It has 85,600 miles. This, as you know, came with 5-liter V10. And most of these cars, I would say 90-95% of them, came with a single clutch SMG, sequential manual gearbox. Which, again, in the fastest setting at high RPM with more than 3/4 throttle application, you gain the fastest shift speeds, and that's really cool. But you can't drive this car like that on the street. That's only for the racetrack. So most of the time while you're driving an SMG on the street, that gearbox is really clunky. It has a very violent interaction. And there's a big stall in the momentum of the car. Literally, like, your sunglasses would slide down the brim of your nose while you were driving because it was such a herky-jerky gearbox. But this car solves all that problems. Now you get to enjoy that 500 horsepower, nearly 400 pound-foot torque, 5-liter V10 that makes all that power. You can enjoy it because you're in control of the actuation with this silky smooth 6-speed manual transmission. Now, JP, I had a cup of coffee at BMW. I worked there for about 5 minutes, but these cars were being sold brand new at the time that I was there. And the guys who I worked with said the manual just didn't work. He said it was not a good manual to go with this car. So one would think that just seeing the manual tied to a V10, you're talking about a recipe for a car that would be extraordinarily fun. But from the few people I know that have had the pleasure of driving these, they said that, and I'm guessing that it has something to do with either a long throw to the shifter, maybe a long take up for the clutch, or perhaps the gears are not closely spaced. I don't know why. Nobody could ever describe it to me, and I don't have driving impressions of my own to share with you. But for some reason, this car never garnered a cult following. And so our car is sitting at $25,000 with 2 hours to go. It's not like it's, a big money ticket item. It's just weird. Why? Do you have any feedback on this? Have you ever experienced one? Do you know why people say they don't work? What's the give?
Yeah, I have not heard that before. I've driven an M6 with the same powertrain, and it was...
Okay, that'll be identical,
And it was, pretty damn awesome. Yeah, the throw was a little long. I don't know, maybe if you're... I mean, because with this era, you come off of something like an E39 M5, that thing was like the perfect powertrain. There's nothing better than that thing. And then you've got something like an E46 M3 of the same, of that era, and those were just like the easiest, fastest cars to drive. So I don't know. I do know that you're absolutely right about the SMG, though. Those things were just absolute dog crap.
I owned one for a couple of years as my daily, and it was terrible.
Our friend Shane Does Stuff, he had one parked out in front of his girlfriend's place one night, and a drunk neighbor ran into his car overnight and pushed it a few feet. He had the bumper fixed or whatever and really didn't think anything of it, and then went to pick the car up, and it just like it ruined the transmission. So he had to battle with the insurance company to try to convince him that that was because of the accident. It was just a nightmare. So this car, I don't know. I way rather have an E39. I've never really liked this body style. And how many times have we said this over and over and over again on another subject? you know, Doug DeMiro, what the dang F, man? Why are you letting these Craigslist crappy looking pictures on your site?
The car's filthy.
Look at this, you guys. The car's dirty. There's RVs in the background. It's a crappy day. I mean, this is a really cool car, even though it's not my favorite BMW. It deserves the respect of having a photographer take some decent photos of this. And you're just not going to get big money for a car that looks like you just don't care. I mean, what the hell, dude? It's in the dirt. There's a bunch of other crappy cars. I mean, look at all these other cars around here. Is this guy just somebody that buys cars off Craigslist and doesn't even care and just like put it on a big trailer because and then I'll sell my Ford Capri that I got in the background or whatever the hell. I mean, just come on, dude. Take the car somewhere that looks cool, at least. Don't let us see all your other garbage that's not in your name in the backyard.
It is a little bit like looking at dirty laundry when you see RVs in the background of your property. It is really strange. I do not explain that, but I get what you're saying. JP, I should also mention that this car has aftermarket 20-inch wheels, and it is a no-reserve auction. AutoCheck said that there was a collision with this car in its history, and yet our car sits at $25,000. So based on the AutoCheck, based on the fact that these aren't great ads, and based on the fact that it's on Cars and Bids, I'm going to tell you, JP, I don't think this thing gets another bid. I'm going to take the 25 that it's sitting at and send it to you and say that it's not going anywhere. There's no way.
Dang you. Look at this background. I'm sorry. Look at this. He's got like a Ford truck and you got the Mustang and then you got an E39 BMW or is it an E36? I can't tell in this picture.
Yeah.
You know, a Cadillac. Is that a Maserati? I mean, it's a bunch of young dudes in a house that are just like slinging used car crap. I would not trust this guy as far as you could throw him. And I don't have any I mean, somebody that buys a car to flip, okay, whatever, but at least try to represent it like you're not just like a sleazy used car loser that can't even get a dealer license. Come on, guys. This is embarrassing. It doesn't deserve another bid. I'm with you. I wish I could bid. I'm going to put a dollar over. You've got me in a corner. I couldn't agree more with you're absolutely right. It sucks.
All right. $25,100. There it is.
No. $25,001. Well, I guess it has to be 100. That's a minimum bid. So $100.
I think it is. I think it has to be 100, but I'm not sure. Doug DeMiro's site is unlike all the others.
Yeah.
All right,
Doug DeMiro. Doug DeMiro, clean up your backyard, man. Start demanding that people take decent photos, and don't let crap like this screw up the rest of your site. I am not interested in putting a car in Cars and Bids anymore because of stuff like this. And you know, because people ask us all the time. I mean, how many times a day do people ask you, Michael? Hey, I'm thinking of selling my car. Which platform should I put it on?
Oh, yeah,
and
totally,
is Cars and Bids worth it?
I'm you just hear like, it more often
no.
than you think.
Yeah, you know, I'd go P Car Market before I'd go Cars and Bids at this point. It's ridiculous.
And we wouldn't play cards. We're from Vegas, and we wouldn't play cards with the guys from P Car Market. How's that tell you?
Mm-hmm. Hey, Long Island. All right, next car. What do we got?
All right, JP, this one as soon as I saw it, I was like, we are definitely covering this car. Feast your eyes on this heap. It's a 1977 Oldsmobile Starfire offered out of Milford, Ohio. It has just 25,000 original miles. This is the Preservation Award winner at the next car show this summer. It's powered by a 305 cubic inch V8 with a 4-speed manual transmission. But JP, look at the front air dam. Look at that wing in the back. This is literally called the Monza Mirage Body Kit. I mean, this thing, does this look like it's ready to go? Monza, by the way, is a very, very fast racetrack in Italy. It is literally called the Cathedral to Speed. And this car absolutely looks like it is on a wing and a prayer.
Nailed it. They just got it so right. It's so Italian. How do they know?
Look at the
hell?
Look at the 13-inch diameter centerline wheels. I mean, and the full red interior. Speed up your flicking through the photos and check out that completely red interior. Red dash, red steering wheel, red carpets, red console, red seats, red everything. The only thing that's black is the shifter handle and the seatbelts. I mean, this thing is just so 70s and so hideous and so amazing all at the same time. It's hard to believe that this wouldn't get into Radwood because it is actually rad before rad. Anyways, JP, I thought it was really interesting to look at and we could just have a laugh at it. But then something really interesting happened. I did my notes on this car last night and it was at $7,000. And at that time, $7,000 was good for five bids. So I put in my notes, I'm like, yeah, this thing will probably make it to 10 grand. Well, I woke up this morning and while we were trying to figure out our electric glitch, somebody went ahead this morning and bid $15,500 at 7:30 in the morning. And I was like, oh, this is amazing. I'm going to get JP twice by saying it's not going to get another bid. Well, then we started the show. And at about 9 o'clock this morning, somebody bid $15,800. And that's three different bidders. So some few people out there think this car is cool and would actually pay stupid money for it. I can't imagine that there's two guys in this country who would give you $15,000 for this car, but I have already been proven wrong. And we have 2 hours to go out of Milford, Ohio. This car is sitting at 15.8 on seven bids from three different buyers. What explain that to me, John. What is it? Is it the gold and red racing stripes? Is it the Monza body kit? Is it the fact that it's an Oldsmobile and it's a sports car? It's a two-door Oldsmobile sports car from the 70s that we never would have even knew existed because we forgot about this car? What is it?
It's the two boomers that got laid for the very first time in the back of one of these that are battling it out. I mean, there's other reason to want this thing. Is this built on a Buick Skylark platform? Is that what the interior is? I haven't seen an interior that red since. I mean, yeah, this is just the ugliest thing I think imaginable. I mean, this gives AMC cars a run for their money. I mean, this thing uglier than a Pacer or a Gremlin or an AMC Eagle? It's right there with it, and it's a General Motors product from the same era. That body kit is something else.
Amazing, man. Yeah.
Wow, and you know, you almost have to respect it for how ridiculous it is. This car, the only reason to own this car is ironically. So if somebody has that extra 15, 20 grand that they really want to, you know, put an exclamation point on the joke, well, they're going to be the funny guy and it's going to cost them, I guess. This is...
Dual
the joke's
quads.
On them, whoever winds up buying it. I don't, this,
dual quad carburetors, headers, 15-inch torque thrust wheels, and a prototipo. And then give me like some glass packs all the way to the exhaust out the back, and I'll make this car cool. It's going to be bitching.
Do it. I double dog dare you. All right. So where,
at seven grand, at seven grand,
land?
I would
know.
Have thought about it, but yeah. At 15 grand, there's no way they are getting my money. So... JP, I mean, I would have to think that the guy who bid $15,500 was $8,000 over the existing $7,000 bid. So he was basically going for the knockout punch. Mm. And then somebody already showed him, well, I want it more than you do. And I just think that the guy who bid the $15,500 can afford another $500. So I actually think this is going to get another bid. And so I am going to change my bid. $10,000 last night to, I don't know, I'm just going to go for the kitschy and 16.5. But, I mean, we're already stupid money. And then who knows if they fight over it from there. But 16.5, I think, brings it home. It would be a record, right?
Has there ever been one of these for sale ever before on a forum? 17.5, I think these two idiots are going to go at it. You know, it.
There you go.
It's going to be like watching a bum fight.
Totally. We should tune in and watch it. It'd be hilarious. Even if they just go up in $100 increments, it'll be. I can't wait to read the comments of watching two boomers fight over a Starion, a Starfire. What is it called?
Right. I don't know.
Starfire. Yeah, an Oldsmobile Starfire. What Starfire is that Oldsmobile speak for dumpster fire? Like what is that name? Starfire.
You might be right. Yeah.
There's no oxygen in space. It doesn't even make sense.
Jeez. All right. Well, let's get off of this weird ass car and get to something that's. I mean, so there it is. I mean, guys, we do the most interesting cars of the day, and that how can you make an argument that that isn't one of the most interesting cars of the day? May not be the most desirable, but certainly most interesting. But not interesting enough to keep talking about. What's next?
Yeah. So I would rather spend $18,750 on this 1989 BMW 325 IS with a 5-speed
also a Preservation Award winner. JP, out of Woodbury, Connecticut, on Bring a Trailer, this car has just 55,000 original miles.
Wow.
The 325s uses a 2.5-liter M20 inline-six. It's got a 5-speed manual gearbox and a limited-slip differential. My favorite E30 color of all time is Alpine White. Yep, that's what this one is. It's got the 14-inch basket weaves. I would upgrade those. I would go a little bit taller. But the manual gearbox and the limited-slip differential and an E30 platform, how can you not have fun? I'm actually shocked that with 2.5 hours to go, this car isn't already at $25,000 or $30,000. You know, we see cars with like 150,000 miles get close to $20,000 or in the, you know, high teens. So why would this car be sitting at 18,000? I would think that this car is going to bring at least significantly more money than where it sits at the moment. This one looks really, really nice. I don't even mind the beige interior, JP, because it's got a full black dashboard. You could throw black floor mats in there, and this is a very livable car. Anyways, really nice car. It's, you know, the snow is starting to melt, so it maybe doesn't bother me that it's in Connecticut. It'd be hard to find one as nice as this. We haven't seen one this clean.
Yeah, this thing is magnificent. I mean, it's amazing that it's already at where it's at, given, I mean, that used to be E30 M3 money. I mean, the idea, oh, somebody spent $30,000 on E30 M3, that's crazy. Now they're like $70,000, $80,000 cars. So to find an E30 of any type that is clean and low miles, especially this late stage of the E30 with the smaller bumpers, this and a hard top, I mean, this car is just blue chip as can be. A clean dashboard. I mean, you know, both of us go crazy over clean dashboards. That just gets us going. I absolutely love this car. I'm saddened that they are this expensive because it just means it's
JP, what are you seeing? It's only at $18,700.
Yeah, but I mean, to me, it's always going to be hard for me to spend more than $10,000 on an E30. Even though they're magnificent cars, and I think they're absolutely, you know, look, I get why they're worth more money. Because I'm old enough to remember when they weren't that expensive, I just can't pull the trigger on something like that. Maybe I could. I don't know. But 18, 20, 25, just no way. Even though I think it's worth that and someone will pay for that, I just can't do it. I couldn't do it. I would have to have an M3 or it would have to be more hopped up. This is a beautiful, beautiful car, though. Where's it going to land?
Do you prefer the revy nature of the four-cylinder over this sort of mundane inline six?
I do, absolutely. The the 318 is definitely the preferred car in my book. Absolutely. That's a good take. It's a good question.
Interesting. Yeah, because I really don't have a lot of experience driving these things. I just know that they handle and that they're fun little sports cars to drive. And this one looks really nice. JP, so last night I said $24,000. And even though it was at 18.5 last night, it's only got really one bid overnight. Let me remind everybody, this is a no reserve auction. It's got 55,000 miles. And yet it's strange. This car is sitting here with 2.5 hours to go on just 7 bids. I put $24,000, but I feel like that number is vulnerable. I think this car is destined for a late surge. So I don't know. I'm just going to go 28 and try to make it a little more difficult for you.
Yeah, I mean, I'll steal your bid. I'll take 24. I definitely think it's going to find a late stage. But if it's at 18 now, that's quite a ways to go. And that's anything over 20 is really stratospheric for an E30. Even one as nice as this one.
Man, that's a nice car.
It really is. I mean, I just went on and on about how I have a hard time ever spending more than $10,000 on an E30. But at the same time, for $25,000, what do you get that is as nice as this, contemporary, and that is, you know, these are unbelievably reliable. They have their little quirks like old German cars, but.
JP, remember we looked at that, what was it? Well, it's really not apples to apples, but we looked at that 190 last week that had a 2.6 inline six with a manual transmission. Now that was a miler, it was 170,000 miles, and it was in a different category. It was like $8,000-$9,000. But like even if it was apples to apples, I would much rather drive this. Like, this would just be such a great car to rock as a daily driver, even in Vegas. If the AC blows cold, What more do you want? What a nice car.
This really is the perfect car. And this could be your last car. Like, you could buy this thing for whatever, 20, 25 grand, and drive it for 350,000 miles. I'm not kidding. Right. I've seen them with 400. It is just a bulletproof. You know, I like the 318 better, but this engine is the better engine from a longevity point of view. They will just go and go and go and go and go. So, man, you're selling me on it. Maybe I'm going to have to go buy it. But, yeah, I don't know if I want to go to Connecticut. All right. Great E30. Right, good luck to the sellers and the buyers.
Absolutely. No reserve auctions. Somebody's taking that car home, JP, so it's probably worth watching. All right, JP, another Polnik special. You and I have been feeling Saabs, and you found yet another one. On Bring a Trailer, we have a 2008 Saab 9.3. This is a Turbo X with a 6-speed manual transmission, offered out of San Jose, California, with just 103,000 miles on the odometer. The Turbo X uses a 2.8-liter V6 with a 6-speed manual. And JP, when I'm done, you'll have to explain to me what cross-wheel drive stands for. What does that mean?
How do you
explain cross-wheel drive? Yeah. I'm assuming that this is an all-wheel drive car and that they have some sort of weird thing, some sort of I don't know. My vernacular is failing me, but whatever.
Version of Quattro or some BS. Yeah.
Yeah, it does have a limited slip differential, and so I wonder: is that in the middle, or is that just on the rear wheels, or is it a limited slip on the front? I didn't really spend any time to look it up, but I was curious to get your take on what cross-wheel drive is. In any case, our car is black on black. It has a very aerodynamic body. And it's a really pretty car. Saabs are good, and this is one of the last nice ones they made before they left our shores. So, anyway, what do you think?
Well, you know, I mean, this is the very last Saab 9.3, or at least darn near it.
Right.
It's, you know, Saab was just trying so hard to hang on during this era. Cars were, all the car manufacturers were having a hard time, and obviously 2008, 2009, during the big crash. And, you know, Saab, even though they were owned by General Motors and they were given all kinds of directives, they had to use General Motors engines and platforms and stuff. They were like the resistance in France, man. They were just like, right. No, we're going to keep doing as much crap the way we want to do it for as long as we can. And I got to think that a cross drive, whatever, is some directive from General Motors. I'm speculating here, these cars don't need to be all wheel drive. The front wheel drive platform was great in the snow and the weather in Sweden, all that stuff. I mean, all the Born From Jets thing you can see in the design language and the interiors on these. And, you know, unfortunately, Saab just couldn't hang on. I really like some of the very last Saabs. The very last designs were pretty interesting where they were just like total FU. Spyker owned them for a nanosecond and then some Indian company got them and that was it.
So really quickly, JP, cross-wheel drive system is an all-wheel drive system designed by Haldex. Who made the diffs, and they made it in partnership with Saab. Now, again, that directive still could have come from GM, but Saab paid Haldex to create this system, and then they came up with this catchy name that they thought they might be able to market to commercial success, and as we know, that didn't happen. They only made 650...
That has Focus Group written all over it.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. They only made 650 of these 9.3 turbos with the cross-wheel drive system, and they were all jet black. So this was... in a certain way, its own special model. And again, I just want to point out that 2.8 liter made 280 horsepower and 300 pound-foot of torque. This is a two-owner car. It's sitting at $8,700 on 14 bids. So, I mean, you know, is this going to bring any real money, JP? They were 40 grand when they were brand new. I mean, they've held on pretty well because the Saab has a loyal following, right?
Yeah, but most of the people that are loyal to Saab want an old one. Everybody wants a 900 for, you know, series from the 80s and early 90s. They don't want the General Motors version. I mean, they're kind of crap. This car is interesting, and I'm quite shocked that it's even as high as it is, given that it has some miles on it. I mean, I think there is kind of some weird attention happening towards Saab and some of these last ones, just because everybody knows it's the end of an era. But and this is a cool car. I've never driven one. Honestly, before this, even though I picked this car, I didn't even know about the stupid all-wheel drive thing. So that's just kind of, to me, all right, they were trying to take a little piece of Audi in the last moment and it didn't work.
Right.
So I don't know. Neat car for less than 10 grand. I'd certainly rather have this than an 08 Audi of any type, just because it's at least interesting.
So I read you the price from last night. It was at $8,700 last night. Mm-hmm. And our car has gotten some love this morning. So again, out of San Jose, California, 2008 Saab 9.3 Turbo X 6-speed with 103,000 miles is now currently at $11,000 with an hour to go. And my bid from last night was $11,500. So now I got to change it. Let's just take a look really quick at what's going on. What's the action this morning? So last night it was at $8,700. And then this morning it got bids at $8,800, $10,000, $10,250, $10,500, $10,750 and $11,000. So there is action on this thing this morning, and they are already fighting over it. So I'm just going to add a grand to my bid and go $12,500 brings it home. And it's sitting at $11,000 with an hour to go, JP. Where are you at?
What'd you say? 12 what?
12,500.
Yeah, gosh.
Yeah, $1,500 from where it's at right now. But there's a bunch of different people fighting over it this morning.
13. I mean, I'm just totally guessing here. That doesn't make any sense
to me too.
That anybody wants this car that much. I mean, an 08, what's the coolest Audi from 2008? Or rather, what's on the A4 platform? So that would be RS or whatever?
S4. An S4 would be, something similar. You'd want an S4.
And so a 2008 S4 would bring, with 100,000 miles on it, how much does that bring?
I don't know. A little more.
$10,000, $15,000, depending on conditions, stuff like that. So, I mean, this is really what this is going for. And this is a more rare car. It's certainly more interesting, more reliable. I don't know. I mean, where do you get this even worked on? I mean, Audis are pretty bad, but Saab? Yeah. But that's really what this car was going after. So I think the person that wants that, wants an RS... A4 is definitely somebody that would want this thing, I guess. I don't know. All right. So moving on. There it is, guys. End of the day on a Tuesday. We had a rough start. Thanks for sticking around, everybody. This has been another edition of Bid Nerd, your daily nerd out on the most interesting cars of the day on Bring a Trailer, Cars and Bids, P Car Market, Rad for Sale, and whatever other auction site happens to pop up overnight. Make sure you come back tomorrow at 9 o'clock. We'll be doing it again. Make sure you tell us what cars you want us to review. And you know what? Compare your bids with ours. Come on here. Get it in the comments and tell us what you think of our bids. You think you're better at this? Show it. Let's see some bids out there from our viewers. And on top of all of that, if you want to go back and look at the cars that we talked about today, all the cars are listed and links to them in the description below.
Where are you at, J. Ron said? Once you put your bids up, post your bids
up. Yeah, buddy. Let's see your bids, guys. All right. See if you got the stones to be a nerd. Sometime in the next day or two, we're going to get our good friend Matt Drobny is going to come on the show.
Ooh.
He is our friend who bought my Chrysler LeBron, the LeBaron convertible, earlier this summer. He's become a really good friend. We met him on Cars and Bids. That's one of the great things about these platforms. That's one of the reasons why we do this show, is because all the great people we've met just kind of messing around for fun on these sites.
Last time we talked to him, he was on a beach in Mexico, and we were lamenting how somebody had bought his car on an auction site and then showed up and tried to negotiate the price.
Yeah. Well, like, he's got yet another issue. A friend of his bought a car on Bring a Trailer, and apparently can't reach the owner of the car to pay for it. So here this guy bought a car, his fee was deducted from his credit card for the purchase of the car, and now he can't reach the owner to pay him for it and arrange a pickup. So
that's
we should
not
know
cool.
more about that over the course of the next couple of days, so we'll get him to come on and tell us the story. That ought to
we
be
We know what auction site that is?
It was Bring a Trailer, yeah. So we'll get more of the details later, but so
there
stick around for that story. And we do have some third nerds in the works for later in the week. So thanks for joining us, guys.
Sweet.
Michael Deeb, thank you. We will see you tomorrow. All right.
Get those nerds!
That's exactly what you should do.
Get those nerds!